has not given you the spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. When I cry,
thank you for lifting.
When I pray,
thank you for lifting.
Didn't understand,
thank you,
you lifted my head. Say it again, but
now, oh Lord,
you are
a shield for me.
You're my glory.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining us. If you're online, thank you for joining us as well. I'm going to read this scripture, Psalm 100. Let's all stand for the reading of God's word.
Amen. Amen.
It says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Amen. And his faithfulness to all generations. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're coming into his presence with singing. Amen?
Amen.
So we invite you to join us as we open up in song as we worship the Lord.
Amen.
All hail the King of We are grateful to you, Lord, because in every situation, we know that the Lord is always with us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
He's always there. He's pulling us through.
Lord, you are true. protective angels around us. Angels who don't even have access like we do. And in his presence, they just cry, holy.
Join in for just a few minutes, but they never stop because you are just that holy, you are just that set apart, you are just that special. Holy, holy, Lord God, we want to see you high and lifted up for all the world to see you for who you are in Jesus' name. You are so special that the train of your robe is so long that it fills the temple. Oh, Father, give us eyes to see you like never before. Help us to see through eyes of faith. Help us to see through eyes of obedience. Lord God, we love to call your name, Father. We love to worship you, Lord. We love to be in your presence, Lord. We love to hear what you have to say. Oh, God, make us a people that are more and more hungry for you as we fast this week. Let us not just be hungry for food. Let us be hungry for you. And I pray that in our hunger that we will be filled. We will be able to go to that next level in you, Lord. Those things that we thought were out of our reach spiritually, Lord God, they will come up close. Where we want a deeper insight into your word, I pray that this week we will get that. Where we wanted to be able to see you and hear you and feel you, Lord God, I pray that this week we can see you and hear you and feel you in Jesus' name. Lord God, I pray that you will confuse the plan of the enemy right now to discourage us, to distract us, to do all the things that he tries to do, Lord God, but I thank you that it won't work. I thank you that the weapons might be formed, but they won't work. Lord God, I pray that you would protect us, Lord God. I pray that there would be a protecting that would go forth. Protect our minds, protect our ears and our eyes, Lord God. That our whole being would be set apart for you in the name of Jesus. For every person in this room, whether they be 6 months old, 6 years old, or 60 years old, Lord God, I pray a protecting would go forth by your spirit, Lord God. That we, your people, would be armed and ready for battle. Lord God, I pray that we wouldn't go out onto the battlefield without our armor on. I pray that we would always be ready and always remember that we do have a foe. We have an enemy that wants to undo everything that you're doing. Even now, he wants to undo everything that you're doing. But I thank you that we have victory in you, Lord God. I thank you that through you, through the blood of Christ, through your kingdom, there's nobody like you. We don't have anything to fear. You are high and lifted up, and you are our Father. You aren't so far away and so lofty that we can't get to you. That you sent your Son, that even though you're high, and even though you're lifted up, and even though you're holy, that we can call upon your name, and we can have confidence that you hear us. Lord God, I thank you that, as my sister said this morning, that not only do you calm the winds and the waves, but you calm us. That not only do you see to the birds of the air and the lilies of the valley, but you see to us. And I thank you for that. I thank you that as you keep the world spinning at the right degree on its axis, and as you mix the air just right so we can breathe it, that you see about us. You see about the little things and the big things, and we thank you for it. Father, I pray that we would submit our lives to you as a living sacrifice, as the word says. Lord God, whatever we could give, it's not enough. But I pray that all that we have, we would give it to you, Father. I pray that you would bless the messengers. He brings forth the word today, that it wouldn't just be business as usual, Lord God, but that he would speak a word that speaks to each of our hearts and that we understand what it is that you would have for us to do and to be in this season. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, church family. Well, I want to welcome everyone on this Sunday morning at Christ Community Church. It is indeed a great honor to be in the presence of our great God and to be able to worship him. I want to thank you for worshiping with us on this particular Sunday. We recognize there are so many great churches throughout the city, and it's just our honor that you guys decide to worship with us. How many of you guys know we serve the same God? It's one church. Different locations, different congregations, different expressions of that, but there's one God. And I just want to say on behalf of Christ Community Church, we are honored that you guys are worshiping with us. Thank you so much. Our hope and our prayer for all of us is that through our worship that we're drawn closer to God, because we mean business. When we come together to worship, we don't do this out of formality. We do this because we need God. As a matter of fact, if I can say this, there's a sense in which we come to worship out of desperation, because we're like, Lord, if I don't connect with you this week, I don't know if I'm going to make it. Amen, somebody. If God, if I don't connect, life is so crazy. Amen, somebody. It's so chaotic out there. There's so many things going on that when I come to church on Sunday morning, when I come to the gathering, it's from a sense of desperation. Like, God, I need you. And so we're just so thankful that you guys decided to worship with us. I want to extend a welcome to all of our, to any guests or first-time visitors. Thank you so much for being a part of our church service on today. We really appreciate it. Just want to let you know that if you want to get more information about our ministry, there's a couple of ways you can reach out to us. You can reach out to us by phone. Our phone number is 216-417-7958. Or you can reach us by email. Our email address is info, that's I-N-F-O, at worshipccc.com. And we would love to connect with you, give you more information about our church, but more importantly, talk with you about the God that we love so much. Church family, just a few announcements I want to make, and we're going to move on to the rest of our service. First thing is, starting tomorrow, we're beginning a four-day journey of fasting. Amen? Amen. And we're looking forward to that. Every year around October, we commit 4 days to fast. And it's always a blessed time. Now, I know on the front end, hearing that you're not going to eat or you're going to adapt your eating over the next 4 days don't sound so encouraging. But when you're in the midst of it, and you're doing it with God's people, and we're bombarding heaven, it's something about putting aside food or putting aside choice food to seek God's presence that reminds you that man should not live off of bread alone, but by every word that comes from God's mouth. And so often we're distracted with the things of this world, and our appetite for the things of God is not that strong. What fasting does, it gives us a chance to do the reverse. It gives us a chance to put aside the things of this world so that our appetite for the things of God will increase. And we find that when we fast, our hunger for the Lord increases all the more. So I hope that you are looking forward to this 4 days of fasting. We're going to talk more about that a little bit later, but I did just want to remind everyone to get your McDonald's in today. Go ahead, slide through Wendy's before, after service, and get your eat on today, because we're going to journey together over the next 4 days and really seek God's face. We're going to provide prayer every night of the fast at 7 o'clock via Zoom, so that you can join in, Zoom in with us, and pray with us, and we're just going to encourage one another and seek God's face together. So again, that's going to start tomorrow, and it's going to culminate. We always go 4 days. We usually end. We end on Thursday. So again, we'll talk more about that a little bit later. Also, I just want to remind everyone, the next Sunday is a very important Sunday for us. We have individuals in our congregation that have consecrated themselves to go through a journey of learning about what it means to be a deacon or a deaconess, learning about what it means to be an elder, and they've committed time to do the research, to do the work, to study books, to even do some labor in our church just in preparation for this role. Well, next Sunday, we're actually going to have an official vote to vote those people into those particular offices in the church. So we really want to encourage you, if you can be in the house next Sunday, please make sure you're in the house. The vote is going to take place after service. Immediately after service, we're going to have the vote. It will be anonymous. And so we have something for you to check. There's going to be strictly anonymous. And so if you can make sure that you're in-house next Sunday, that would be really much appreciated. If you can't make it to church on Sunday, or you find yourself anticipating to come to church on Sunday, but something ends up coming in your way, we're also going to provide the vote through our webpage as well. If you go to worshipccc.com, on Friday at 12 o'clock, we're going to open up the voting. So 12 o'clock on Friday, 12 o'clock afternoon, in the afternoon, we're going to open up the voting. Just go to worshipccc.com. You will see in the members area a place where you can click on it. You can cast your vote. And that's going to be available up until 12 o'clock on Sunday, 12 o'clock in the afternoon on that following Sunday. So if you can't make it to church next Sunday, or you're anticipating coming to church, but something gets in the way, you can vote between Friday at 12 o'clock in the afternoon up through Sunday, 12 o'clock in the afternoon. And you can do it through our webpage, worshipccc.com. We will send out a text message just to remind you and let you know how to access that. But this is something we take very seriously. We don't take it lightly when a person is appointed to be a leader in our church. Leadership at Christ Community Church is very important. It's something we take very seriously, and we want you guys to weigh into that decision. And so, again, if you can be in house next Sunday, that's great, so you can cast your vote. If not, it will be available on Friday at 12 o'clock at worshipccc.com, and you can cast your vote that way as well. Also, the first Sunday in November, I believe it's November 5th, we are going to have new members class. So anyone that's interested in joining the ministry, you can be a part of that. And that following Sunday, man, November is a really exciting month for us. That following Sunday, we're going to actually install all of our officers. And so on November the 12th, that's the second Sunday in November, we're going to have a special service. Following that service, we will have an installation service as well. So a lot of exciting things is going on in our ministry, a lot of things we're really encouraged by. And I just, again, want to say how much we appreciate you guys. We don't take it for granted that you guys have decided to do life with us. We're so honored to be able to do life with you, and we're so honored to be able to pursue God with you. So thank you so much. We have one more special announcement that we need to make. Ms. Audrey is going to come up, and she's going to make an announcement. And then following that, we're going to continue on with our service. So, Ms. Audrey. Hey, y'all, clap it up for Ms. Audrey. She's up here doing her thing.
Welcome, church family. October is Pastor Appreciation Month. So next week, which is going to be Sunday, October 29th, we really want to take some time to show love to Pastor LaVert as well as Sister Kelly. Everybody knows how humble Pastor is, and traditionally we would collectively give a gift. But this time, we just want to encourage everybody to individually, whatever God places on your heart, as a means of showing your appreciation and love for their family, please do so. So next week or even after service, I'll be collecting any cards that you may have. Miss Mariam has some cards at the back if you just don't have time to go get one that you can sign, you can write some words. It's not mandatory, of course, but as much as this family does for us each and every day of the year, please, please, please just show your love and appreciation for them. If you have any questions, I'll be here after church. And, of course, I'll be here next Sunday to collect everything, okay? All right, have a good day.
All right, church family. So we're going to go ahead and move into our time of offering. Before we do that, we're going to release our young people to go to Children's Church. We have Children's Church and Youth Group today. And so you guys, please feel free to go ahead and go to Youth Group and Children's Church. See you guys later. Have fun. All right. See you guys later. Have fun. Thank you, thank you. All right, have fun at Children's Church and at Youth Group. Okay, see you later. All right, all right. We're going to go ahead and transition to our time of offering. Again, we just want to say thank you guys so much for allowing the Lord to use you to help support this ministry. I just need to, if can I boast on God real quickly? I just need to say God has been so faithful to us. Let me just reassure you, just in case if the thought ever came to your mind, God has been so gracious to us. Our bills are paid. We're doing well. We got reserves. We're doing good out here by the grace of God. And so I just want to give glory to God for that, because God has been so faithful in sustaining this ministry. We're just so honored to be a part of God's family, first and foremost. To be able to say that God is our Father is a blessing. But to be able to serve on God's behalf, it's a blessing as well. And we have that privilege here at Christ Community Church. And it's because of God using you, because God using us to help support this ministry, that we're able to do the work that we're doing. And so God has been so gracious. God has been so kind to us. He is so worthy of our praise. And I just want to say thank you for allowing the Lord to use you to contribute and help support this ministry financially. Just want to remind you of the ways you can help support our ministry. You can give by going to our webpage, which is worshipccc.com. Click on the Give tab, and then you'll get the instructions like you give that way. You can also text to give. Just simply text CCCGIVING to 73256. Or if you're in-house, you can give your offering to the greeter in the back. There's actually a box back there. We'll make sure it goes to the appropriate place. Or if you're at home, you can mail your contribution to our physical location, which is 2065 Lee Road, Cleveland Heights, Ohio, 44118. Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you so much for the blessing of being a part of your family. What a blessing to be able to call you our Father. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that you're not impersonal, but you are a personal God, and you love us, You love us individually. You love us collectively, but you love us individually, that you know who we are. And so, Father, we appreciate that, God, and we thank you, Lord. We love you, God. We celebrate you, Lord. We celebrate all that you do for us. And, God, we just thank you for this opportunity to be a part of your family and to be able to express that in the way that we worship. We love you, Father. We honor you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's continue in worship. We're going to bless the name of Jesus. He's worthy of all our praises.
Amen. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you so much for the blessing of being able to be in your presence with your people. What a joy. What a privilege, God. And we don't want to take it for granted. I know so often, God, especially in the States, we take it for granted that we have the opportunity to go to a Sunday morning service. But Father, that's not always the case. In some parts of the world, Lord, they're not able to gather so openly. But Father, we thank you that we can gather on this Sunday and to be able to worship you. And Father, we do want to pray for our brothers and sisters in other parts of this world that's dealing with persecution. They're not able to freely worship you the way that we are. Father, we pray that they will be encouraged. We pray that you would give them the peace that they need, Lord, to push through the situations that they're facing. Father, may they know that there are believers in America that's also thinking of them as they go through what they're going through. Father, remind them, God, that we're united together as one big church, and we think about them. And so, Father, we pray your blessings for them. God, we certainly want you to bless us. We certainly want you to bless us with your presence. But if it's okay, God, right now, we want to pray for them, that you will bless them, and that you will bless them with your presence. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, God, that you are a God that sees us. You're El Roi. And that we're just so blessed, God, to be in relationship with you. We love you, Father. We honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen, church family. Well, if you have your Bibles, can you join me, please, in the book of Hebrews? And today we want to look at Hebrews chapter 11. That's the book of Hebrews chapter 11. And we want to start reading at verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 11. And we want to start reading at verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 11. Starting at verse 1. The word of God reads like this. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous, God commending him by accepting his gift. And through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death. And he was not found because God had taken him. Now, before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists, and that he reward those who seek him. Amen. May God add a blessing to the hearing and reading, the reading and hearing of his holy word. Amen. Amen. Well, every year, as we announced earlier, in the month of October, we commit 4 days to fast and to pray together. And typically during this time, we have a focus. Our focus this fast is going to be on faith. And what I want to argue today and what we want to focus on over the course of these next 4 days is the fact that faith is vital. It is absolutely vital. It is absolutely necessary. It is critical. Faith is essential. It is vital to the health of your relationship with God. If you want to have a healthy relationship with God, you need to have some faith. If you're going to grow in your relationship with God, you got to have faith. And the reason why is because faith is the way that we relate to God. In this dispensation, God has designed it in such a way that we connect with him primarily through faith. So if we're going to grow in our relationship with God, you got to have faith. Let me say it like this. If you're not growing in faith, then you're probably not growing in your relationship with God. If your faith is not being developed, being cultivated, then you're probably not growing in your relationship with God. Our relationship with God is not measured based on how long we've been saved. It's not like you get a gold star for being saved 5 years. Then you get 2 gold stars when you're saved for 10 years. It doesn't work like that. Our relationship with God is not measured based on our years, not even our education. It's not like your faith or your relationship with God is based on how much education you have or even your gifting. No matter how gifted you are, your relationship with God is not based on that. Your relationship with God is measured based on your faith. So it's important that we both understand what faith is and we commit ourselves to evaluating our faith. And that is what we want to focus on during this fast. During this fast, we want to have a self-evaluation of what's going on with our faith. Hebrews chapter 11 is important as it relates to faith because it is full of faith. In this chapter, we have a definition of what faith is, and we see the application of faith in the lives of believers. So what we want to do this morning is we just want to pull out some truths about faith from Hebrews chapter 11. The first thing I want you to see from this chapter is right out the gate, this chapter helps us understand the nature of faith. The nature of faith. Look at what it says here in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 1. It says, now faith is, very important word there, faith is. It's defining what faith is. It's letting us know what is faith, what it is. What is faith? Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Notice that it describes what faith is. And it describes 2 elements of faith. First of all, this is really interesting. First of all, it says that faith is the embodiment of God's truth and God's character. Let me say that one more time. Faith is the embodiment of God's truth and God's character. The Greek word that's used here for assurance is hypostasis. Hypostasis. This is a very interesting word, the word for assurance here. It's interesting, and it's kind of hard to bring this word from the Greek into English because there's so many different dynamics related to this word. The word represents the embodiment of something. That's what the word represents. It represents the embodiment, capturing something. Let me show you how this word is used in another place so that you can get the idea of the full force of this word. In Hebrews chapter 1 and verse number 3, the Bible talks about the glory of Jesus and who Jesus is in his exalted state. And notice what the Bible says here. Hebrews 1 and verse 3, the Bible says, he, that's Jesus, is the radiance of the glory of God. And look at this, church family. And the exact imprint of his hypostasis, of his nature. He's the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sin, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Notice what the text says here. The text says that Jesus is the exact imprint of his hypostasis, of his nature. In other words, Jesus is the embodiment of God. If you see Jesus, you see God. All you need to see God, is to look at Jesus because he is the embodiment of who God is. This is exactly what the Bible says. This is consistent all throughout the scriptures. For example, John chapter 8 and verse 1, the Bible says, no one has ever seen God. The only God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known in reference to Jesus. The Bible says in Colossians 1 and verse 19 that in Christ, in Jesus, in him, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. So in Jesus is the embodiment of God. He's the exact impression of the nature of God. And in a similar way, in Hebrews chapter 11, faith is the embodiment of the truth and character of God. That's the reason why I love the King James Version translation of this verse. Y'all know I got a little King James Version in me, right? Every now and then it comes out. I love the King James Version, the way they translate this verse. Look at how they translate it in the KJV. It says, now faith is the substance. You see, they're trying to get at what this word is. It's the substance. It's more than just an ideal. It's a substance. It's an embodiment of the things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is more than just a mental exercise. It is the substance upon which we place our hope. It's the assurance of things hoped for. Now, we need to take our time here because this is really important. The Bible says faith is the assurance of things hoped for. It's the hypostasis of things hoped for. We got to take our time here because the word hope is important. You do understand we live in a day where everybody talks about faith. But your faith is only as strong as that in which you place your faith in. Just because you have faith don't mean anything. It just means you have faith. But your faith is only as strong as that in which you place your faith. If the object of your faith is shaky, then the outcome of your faith will be shaky. Now, I need to let you guys know, y'all gonna be mad at me about this because I was kind of discouraging last week to some of our members. At the end of service last week, I was sharing with some of our members that more than likely the Browns were gonna lose last Sunday playing against San Francisco. I just knew based on the 49ers record that we were gonna lose that game. And I need to apologize to y'all because I woke up the next morning, I ain't even watch it. I ain't even want to see the damage. And I woke up that next morning and I was like, man, we won? Really? That's the move of God right there, right? But my faith wasn't that strong because the object of my faith is not that strong, quite honestly. If the object of your faith is shaky, then the outcome of your faith will also be shaky. Biblical faith is the embodiment of God's character and truth. Therefore, biblical faith is not like, biblical hope is not like worldly hope. We can't pour into this word hope the same kind of hope that we have that the Browns will win the game today. We can't put that same meaning of hope, the same kind of hope that I have that I will grow Afro one day. That is not the same meaning. Worldly hope is something different. Another word that we can use for worldly hope is wish. It's wish. A wish is not the same as hope. A wish is having a want for something, but you know that you may not get that thing you want. So you're wishing you can get it, but you know there's a possibility that you won't get it. Biblical hope is not having a strong want for something, but you're not sure of the outcome of it. That's not biblical hope. Don't pour that meaning into hope when you see hope in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. Biblical hope is an expectation that God will make good, that God will keep his promise. That's biblical hope. Biblical hope is based on the fact that God has a track record of always keeping his word. Biblical hope is based on the fact that our faith is the embodiment of what? God's truth and God's character. In other words, if it's on God's character and God's truth, it's going to happen. That's our hope. Our hope is the expectation based on who God is that what God promised, God will do. The fact of the matter is this. We serve a God of promise. Y'all know that, right? We serve a God of promise. I mean, we see God operating as a God of promise all throughout the scriptures. I mean, think about when God called Abraham. What does God call Abraham to do? To leave his family. And then God gives him a promise. All throughout the scripture, God is giving promises. As a matter of fact, even up to today, we're living our lives based on the promise of salvation. We're living our life based on that. We ain't got it yet, but we're living our life based on the promise of it. So what you have is you have the promise of God on one side and you have your current situation on the other side. And in between your current situation and the promise of God is faith. Faith says, listen, I ain't over there yet, but I'm going to be there. Faith does not say, I wish I would be there because there's no doubt in my mind that I'm going to get there. What faith says is that even though I don't see it right now, I know it's going to happen. Why do you know it's going to happen? Why are you so confident in this? It's because I know the one in whom I place my faith is able to come through. I know in whom I trusted that he always made good on his promises. It's not wishing and wanting for something to happen. It's just waiting for God to bring the manifestation of it. Faith is the assurance that it's going to happen. It's the assurance. It's the embodiment of the fact that God is trustworthy. His character is dependable. And because I know that, I know it's going to happen. But faith is so much more than that. Faith is not only the assurance, the substance, the hypostasis of the things hoped for, but faith is also the proof of what has not yet manifested. I don't need to see it manifest to know that it's going to manifest. Because all I need is faith. Because faith is the proof. That's all I need is faith. I don't need to see anything. If God said it, then I know it's going to happen. It is my proof. Did he say it? He said it? All right, that's all I need. That is my proof. Faith is the proof. It's interesting because in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 1, I love the word that's used here. It says that faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. That word, conviction, means evidence. It's the proof. It's the evidence. Faith is fueled by the history and character of the person in whom you're placing your faith. And when you know God is trustworthy, you know God's going to come through. As a matter of fact, I encourage you guys throughout the 4 days of this fast to keep going back to Hebrews chapter 11. Because Hebrews chapter 11 is a track record of God's proven faithfulness to his people. What you read in Hebrews chapter 11 is by faith, this person conquered that situation. And by faith, that person conquered that situation. And by faith, this person dealt with that situation. All throughout the chapter, you see how by faith, God moved on behalf of the lives of his people. It's a track record of God's proven faithfulness to his people. We see how God worked over and over and over again in the lives of his people that were facing challenging situations. This is the reason why, if I could throw a pitch in for this, this is the reason why it's so important to read the Bible. It's so important to read the Bible because in the Bible we see God's faithfulness. Sometimes we just need to be reminded. Sometimes life hits you so hard that you just need to be reminded that God is faithful. Sometimes life gives you a Mike Tyson punch. When I was growing up, Mike Tyson was a bad dude. And Mike Tyson had the ability within the first few seconds to knock somebody out. I never know how he did it. I'll be analyzing how he did it. But he had this punch that was real quick, knock somebody out. Sometimes life does that to you, doesn't it? It gives you no time. Let us finish up this round. It gives you no time. It just throw you with punches, all kind of combinations your way. And sometimes you just need to be reminded in the midst of all the punches that's thrown at you that God is faithful. That's why you got to read the Bible. I don't understand believers that don't read the Bible. No condemnation towards anybody. But I know for me, if I don't have his word, I don't know how I'm going to make it. I don't get skipping out on reading your Bible, going days without reading the scriptures, like never touching the Bible, never putting your eyes on it. I don't get that because I need the reminder that we serve a God that is strong, that is powerful, that has a character in which we can depend upon, and God will make good everything that's wrong. I need that reminder. That's why the Bible says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17 that faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. You want to grow in your faith? Read the Bible. Quick way to grow in your faith, read the Bible. I don't care how many gospel songs you listen to. Now, I like gospel music. Don't get me wrong, I like Christian music. But that's no replacement for reading the Bible. I don't care how often you come to church. You could come to church every single day. And I encourage you to guys come to church, not every day, right? Don't come on Mondays, we ain't here, right? Every other day you can come, though, right? But going to church every day does not replace reading the Bible. You can get excited on church with the most expressive excitement about who God is. But that does not replace reading the Bible. Reading the Bible is a reminder that God is faithful, and you need that in your life. And this evidence becomes so strong that it becomes a conviction. It becomes a conviction. A conviction is something that you are so strongly convinced of that it drives everything you do. That's how you know it has moved from just simply belief to conviction, because it drives everything you do. Check this out, church family. If you claim to have faith and it does not influence everything about your life, then you need to reevaluate your faith. Say this one more time. If you claim to have faith, but that faith does not influence your life, you have to reevaluate your faith. Because one of the most important things about faith, and we see this in this chapter, is that when you have this kind of faith that Hebrews 11 is talking about, when you have this type of faith, then that faith becomes your witness. Faith is our witness. Let me say that one more time. Faith is our witness. Your witness as a believer is not your Bible knowledge. Now, I'm all for growing in knowledge of the Word of God. I'm all for that. But that's not your witness as a believer. Your witness as a believer is not your gifts. Now, I'm all about people operating their gifts, but that does not give witness to your faith and your relationship with God. Your service in church don't even do it. Your witness is your faith. Notice what he says here in verse number 2. Let me prove this to you from the Bible. Look at what he says here in Hebrews 11 and verse 2. For by it, what is the it? The it is their faith. Is their faith. For by it, the people of old received their commendation. By their faith. The word that's used here for commendation is martyrio. You may hear from the word martyrio the word martyr, because the word martyr comes from this word. The word martyr means witness. It means somebody that gave witness to God. And we understand it as somebody that dies for their faith. They give testimony through the sacrifice, the giving of their life to God. What this verse is saying is that they gave witness to their faith, gave witness to their relationship with God by their faith. They gave witness by their faith and how they lived and how they trusted God in the midst of challenges. Their faith carried them through the difficulties of life. Their faith carried them through the ups and downs of life. Their faith carried them through those sticky situations. It was their faith that gave testimony to their relationship with God. Here's the thing about faith. Here's the thing about faith. The thing about faith, unlike those other things, is that those other things are spectacular things that happen in the moment. For example, you can have Bible knowledge and try to impress people with your Bible knowledge. Oh, I know where Revelation is at. Look at me, I know my Bible. And you may impress somebody, but that says nothing about your life. That just says you know where Revelation is at. You can impress somebody by your gift. I mean, you can sing, not sing, but sing. You can preach like nobody's business, but that says nothing about your life. Because how many of you guys know you can preach well today and cut somebody out tomorrow? You can serve in a church. You could be in the church as soon as the doors open to the doors close and be serving. But that says nothing about your life. What faith is, on the other hand, is faith is the daily grind of trusting God moment by moment by moment by moment. It's away from the spectacular. It's away from the spotlight where everybody can see you operating the things you enjoy doing. Faith is on the ground when they cut your lights off, when you got no food in the refrigerator, when your children are acting crazy, when your parents are acting crazy for some of us, right? Faith is that daily grind. And I'm convinced that people are not so much impressed by the spectacular. What they're impressed by is the moment by moment, the day to day, the daily grind. That's the reason why Your works and your life speak louder than what you say. Yeah, brother, I hear you can preach real good, but on Monday I saw you doing some crazy stuff. Yeah, you look good on Sunday, but what you doing on Monday? It's the daily grind. When people see a consistency in your life of trust in God, faith in God, depending upon God, consistently displayed in your life, that gives witness to your faith. That type of faith honors God. That type of faith honors God. God is honored by that kind of faith. It's interesting. This is so interesting to me. I'm so glad that we're focusing on faith during our fast. Because when you study the Bible, study it very closely, one of the things that the Bible says that God is impressed by is not how good you look, not even how well you preach or sing or dance or do any of the spectacular. What God is most impressed by when you study the Bible very closely is faith. That's what God likes. Like, if you were to ask God, like, I don't know if we do this enough, if we just sit back and say, God, what do you want? Like, God, what do you like? We often come to God, God, give me what I like. Give me what I want. But let's take a step back and say, what does God like? What does God want? And one of the things you notice in Scripture is that God is impressed by faith. Like, God is moved. Faith does something to God. Faith moves God. It touches God's heart. Let me show you this from the text, Hebrews 11 and verse 6. Notice what the Bible says. It's so interesting. The Bible says, and without faith, you see that? It says it in the negative. And without faith, it is impossible. You see the word impossible? Let me tell you what that means in Greek. Impossible. It means impossible. Like, this is impossible. Like, it cannot happen. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Now, this verse is very important in understanding faith. Notice that it says, if you don't have faith, but he can preach, but you don't have faith. Yeah, but she can sing. But if you don't have faith, but yeah, but they cute. If you don't have faith, you will not please God. That's what the text says. Now, you may please others. You may entertain some folks. You may have some people leaving church feeling good. But God is like, that is a reject if it doesn't come from a place of faith. Think of all the times that Jesus expressed how frustrated he was with the lack of faith from his disciples. Now, yeah, some Jesus get frustrated, right? The Son of God. It seems that God gets frustrated, if I can use that in a respectful way, but it seems that God gets frustrated by the lack of faith. It seems that when God sees faith not displayed, that does something to God. Let me show you this in the ministry of Jesus. Luke chapter 24 and verse 25. This is when Jesus is on the road to Emmaus, and he's talking to people about the scriptures. And look at what Jesus says, Luke 24 and verse 25. He said to them, oh, foolish ones. It's like he's throwing up his hands like, man, y'all foolish. So slow to believe. So slow to believe. Where's your faith? So slow to believe the prophets, what the prophets have spoken. Remember in Matthew chapter 17 when a man brought his son to the disciples and they couldn't heal him? They couldn't cast out the demon? Jesus comes down in Matthew 17 and verse 17. Jesus says, oh, faithless and twisted generation. I like that. Jesus said, y'all all twisted. How long am I to be with you? My goodness, the lack of faith does something to Jesus. How long am I to bear with you? Bring the boy to me. I said that, but the text says, bring him here to me. Faith does something to the heart of God. You remember the woman that had the issue of blood? And she just had enough faith. She just had enough faith to say, if I just touch the hem of his garment, if I just touched it, I will be made whole. She just had that kind of faith. Remember what Jesus said to her? Bible says, Matthew 9 and verse 22, Jesus turned and seeing her, he said, take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well. And instantly the woman was made well. Matter of fact, you remember, I love this in Matthew chapter 8. A centurion came to Jesus, and Jesus was just impressed. I mean, the Bible says, it's almost as if Jesus was taken by surprise. By what? Not by the fact that this man had authority or anything about this man, but by his faith. Look at what the scripture says, Matthew 8 and verse 10. And when Jesus heard this, he marveled. He was like, whoa. Jesus took a step back, like, whoa. And said to those who followed, he says, truly, I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. Even when Jesus tells us to pray in Luke chapter 18, he says, men ought always to pray and never lose heart. At the end of that, he says, but will I find faith? Let me read it for you. Luke 18 and verse 6, he talks about how an unrighteous judge was being annoyed by this widow, and eventually the unrighteous judge caved in. And he says, if the widow can cause the unrighteous judge to cave in, don't you think God will provide for his people? And look at what he says here in Luke 18 and verse 6. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge says, and will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him day and night? And will he not delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, watch this. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? It's as if God is searching for faith. It's like God's like, will somebody just believe in me? Will somebody trust my truth and my character enough that they will grab hold of that and just believe in me? The Bible says that God is not moved by our religious activities. We're moved by that. That person serves well in the church. I mean, I grew up in a church situation that God bless my church. I so love the church I grew up in. But we really believed in working hard for the Lord. And I'm not trying to knock that. That's important. But religious activity does not equate pleasing God. That impresses people. That person, that brother at church all day, he's something. And God, like, he ain't nothing. I mean, God is saying he ain't nothing, but he is something, but he's not like he's pleasing God. Because God is not moved by religious activity. God is moved by faith. As a matter of fact, did you know you can do religious stuff from a faithless place? You do it to be seen by man. Be careful of everybody that always wants the spotlight. They want everybody to know what they're doing, right? I mean, some people feel like, man, you better recognize what I did. I mean, you swept one day, and you want everybody to say, hey, brother so-and-so swept the floor on one day, and you mad at me because I didn't acknowledge that. I mean, come on, we don't operate like that in church. All of us sweep the floor. You might, on any given Sunday, you might see any of us with a broom. You can do religious stuff from a faithless place. But you got to have faith if you're going to impress God. One source put it like this: real fellowship with God cannot exist without faith. It just don't exist. Real fellowship with God don't exist without faith. You see, we want to serve God and have fellowship with God from a safe place. Well, we don't have to trust God. Like, God, I'm going to believe in you, but I don't really want to trust in you like that. Like, I'm going to have my own security, make sure my life is intact, make sure I really don't need you, and then I have a relationship with you. That's not faith. Faith says, God, I can't do this thing without you. But we don't like that place because that's uncomfortable, because we like to think we got it together, don't we? We like to think we all that and then some, right? I mean, let's just tell it to you. Let's have a conversation. We like to believe that we don't really need God. Like, I'm doing God a favor by coming to church on the real. God, you lucky I'm here. As if, you know, we don't really need you. Like, I was doing fine just without you. And then the worldwide virus hit the world. Just to remind us that no matter how advanced, no matter how much you think you got it together, in a moment, I could shut the whole world down. Who would have ever thought the world is shut? You can't go nowhere? You think you could do life without God? I mean, God, take your breath away. You dead. There's no real fellowship with God without faith. You want to get right with God? Put your faith game up. Why is that? Well, first of all, notice what it says in the text. Because for you to relate to God, you got to, first of all, believe that he exists. Got to believe that he exists. Now, this is important. This is really important. Stay with me here. This is important because you can believe things about God and not believe in God. Don't confuse the two. Just because a person believes things about God does not mean that they believe in God. The difference is believing things theologically, but not believing them from experience. We can know certain things about God from a theological perspective. And quite honestly, that's where many of us really want to live our faith. We really want to live our life from just a purely theological bubble. Like, I just want to read the Bible, learn about you, God. I want to learn about how you're faithful. I want to learn about how you're trustworthy. Like, I want to learn about how you come through, but I don't want to experience that. I just want to know it in my head. I want to be able to teach a theology class and tell other people that look at what thus says the word of God. God is faithful. I want to know you from that place. But it's when we go through things. It's when we go through some stuff that we begin to ask serious theological questions. Now, we ask theological questions from a bubble when everything is going well. But when you're going through some stuff, you start to ask some serious theological questions. And you know what's the fundamental question that people ask when they go through stuff? They claim all this faith in God. I trust God. I believe in God. I have faith in God. They start going through some stuff. The first thing they ask is, where is God? Well, I thought you knew God was there. You just taught a whole class about God. You just argued for the existence of God. What do you mean, where is God at? It's something about when you go through some pain. It takes you from the realm of just pure knowledge to knowing God from a whole nother place. You begin to ask the question, where is God? Here's the thing. Head knowledge does not mean faith. That just means you got some head knowledge. And you impress people with head knowledge. I know what revelation is at. Nah. I know more than you. Yeah, okay. That's impressive. Great. You know what revelation is at. But I don't mean you got faith. Now, head knowledge, don't get me wrong. Y'all know I like theology. Y'all know I like knowing about the Bible. It's important in shaping your faith. But it doesn't replace faith. Faith is what Job expressed when he went through what he went through. When Job was going through his stuff, he wasn't quoting theologians. He wasn't saying, hey, Martin Luther said, John Calvin said, Martin Luther the King said. He wasn't quoting no theologians or civil rights leaders. When Job was going through, he was like, man, I need God right now. Like, I know some stuff about God, but God, I need you right now. Look at what he says here in Job 19 and verse 25. He said, look, I'm going through all this stuff, and look at the thing that helped him go through this. He says, in the midst of what he's going through, he says, I know that my Redeemer lives. Like, I can't articulate it well in theological terms right now, but the one thing I know he lives. And at the last, he will stand upon the earth. And then he goes on to say, and after my skin has been destroyed, in my flesh, I will see him. I will see God. Whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. My heart faints within me. It's not just about having head knowledge. It's about knowing God. And if the reality that God exists does not affect your life, then you may not truly believe that God exists. Some people say they believe that God exists, but if it doesn't affect your life, you got to really evaluate, do you believe that God exists? Maybe you like the ideal of God. Maybe you like the idea that if anything goes wrong, I got somebody to fall back on. As if God is like my plan B. Like, I'm going to do life, I'm going to do me. Then if things fall apart, I always got God. I'm going to go right back to church. As if God's like a good idea. Like, when things go chaotic, we just need to have God. But you have not fully surrendered to the reality of God. This is what we call practical atheism. Practical atheism is where you affirm by your words that you believe in God, but you live your life as if God doesn't matter. You say there's a God by your word. I mean, you even come to church every now and then. You pop in some gospel every now and then, and you say, I believe there's a God. But in your life, you act like God doesn't exist. You claim to be a person that believes in God, but you live like a person that doesn't believe in God. The reality of God should impact our lives. It's interesting because the Bible says, is not just affirming that God exists. But look at what the text says. Read it carefully. I love this. Man, I love this. I'm gonna stop. I've got to wrap this up. I love this. It's not just that we affirm that God exists, but it's the type of God that he is. It's not just affirming that there is a God, but it's affirming the type of God that he is. Look at what the text says in Hebrews 11 and verse 6. It says, and without faith it is impossible to please him, for whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists. And, you see the word and? Not enough just believe that he exists. There's another dynamic related to this. And that he rewards those who seek after him. It's not just that God exists, but check this out, family, that God rewards those that seek him. Now, actually, in the Greek, this is a little bit stronger. In the Greek, when it says he rewards, that word rewards is actually referring to who God is. Another way you can translate this is that God is a rewarder. He rewards because he's a rewarder. That's who he is. That's part of his nature. It affirms something about who God is, that God is a rewarder. You seek him, God will reward you. In other words, God wants you to experience him. It's not like God is standoffish. You ever met somebody that was standoffish? You trying to die. Y'all know I like to be up in everybody's face, right? My wife got to help me out with that. I'd be all up in everybody's face. They keep like, they don't want to see you like that. They don't want to be with you like that. I'm like, what's going on? How you doing? You know? They trying to move on. Like, everything good in your life. They trying to go down the street. I'm like, everything straight? I think everybody wants to just hang out with me. God is not standoffish. God's like, no, I want you to experience him. Experience me. God's position towards those who seek him is to always embrace them. Let me say that one more time. God's position towards all those who seek him is to embrace those that seek him. Think about what Jesus says. Matthew 7 and verse 7. He says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be open to you. For everyone, y'all see that in the text? For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, it will be open to him. God wants to make himself available. He's not trying to hide himself. He wants you to experience him. But it's interesting, though, the thing about God is that although God has the ability to, God does not force himself upon anybody. If who God is not enough to draw you to God, then there is nothing else that any of us can do. The fact that God is faithful, he's gracious, he's merciful, if that's not enough, if that's not a good enough pitch to bring you to God, then there's nothing else they can do it. God wants you to seek him. It's interesting because this word seek, it means to thoroughly seek God out. Some translations, they even translate it as he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. The idea behind this word is that not that you try to seek God out when you got problems. Let me just say this, the best way I can say it. God would not be played. You know what I mean by God would not be played? You know how we play, folks. We want to use him when we want something. Right? Butter up your teacher when you're trying to get an A. Butt up your parents when you're trying to get some money, right? We try to play people. And we try to bring that same mentality to God because we feel like we're a player, player, player. That's my life. I'm a player. I know how to play people. I'm a player, player. Well, your play is stopping when it comes to God because God will not be played. God knows when you're trying to misuse him, trying to abuse him. God knows when you only praying because you want God to move on your behalf. Someone was like, I'm seeking God, but you're seeking God for the wrong reasons. You're seeking God so that God can deliver you from whatever you're going through, and as soon as you are delivered, you're like, all right, God, I'll check you out later. I'll check you out right before I die. Nah, to seek him means that you're seeking him because you want him. To seek him means that no matter what my current life situation is, God is always on the top of my priority list. No matter if things are going well, it's not like God steps down a notch on my priority list. And I'm like, things are going well, God. You blessed me with a house. You blessed me with a car. You blessed me with all these things. So now I'm going to put those things where you were at. I still got you on the list, but they're going to be above you. No. When things are going well, God, you're still at the top of the priority list. And when things are going bad, when things are challenging, guess where God is at? The same place. And when things are just aight, That's how we say it, right? When things are aight, guess where God is at? He's still at the top of the priority list. That's what it means to see God. You know what it means to see God? What it means to see God is that I am regularly pursuing my relationship with God. Not just swinging from Sunday to Sunday, but regularly throughout my life. Like, my life pattern is that I'm pursuing God. I'm seeking God. I'm trying to learn more about God. I'm praying to God. I'm reading His word. That's what it means to seek God. That's what it means to seek God. And the Bible says, those that seek God, He is a rewarder. He's a rewarding God. But what does He reward us with? I want to end with three precious realities that God rewards us with when we seek Him. And I think you can find all these in the text, definitely in the Bible. But you see this derive, I think, for the most part, from Hebrews chapter 11. First of all, when you seek God as a rewarder, one of the first rewards you get is the commendation of your faith. Get the approval, this person served well. This person served well. It's kind of like what Jesus said. When Jesus said about the parables and He tells about the manager will look at the servant and say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You get the approval, the commendation of your faith. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I don't want to live this life and impress all y'all and then stand before God and God be like, yeah, you're all right. No, I want God to be able to say, well done. I mean, I appreciate you guys as well. I mean, we all need encouragement, but your encouragement does not translate into eternal gain. You give me encouragement for this moment, right? As soon as you leave, that encouragement is gone, right? And I'm going to need you to encourage me again next time because that encouragement didn't last that long, right? But when God commends you, it's something that lasts. I love this because the Bible says that there's going to be a day when all of God's people that have lived by faith, that have gone through the challenges and the tough things that we all have gone through, there's going to be a day when those faithful will be commended by God. Look at what the text says. Hebrews 11 and verse 39. And it says, and all the people that He was talking about right under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit that have been living by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised. Why? Since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. In other words, we stand on the legacy of those people before us that were faithful. And God has not fully recognized them yet. He has not fully commended them yet. And the reason why is because He's waiting for the day where all God's people make it there. And check this out. There's other people coming after us that should be standing on our legacy of faith. And you may feel unappreciated right now, but I guarantee you, if you keep being faithful to God, there is a day where God will commend you and recognize you along with all the faithful of God. The commendation. Now, I don't want to be there. And God like, well done, all y'all. And I'm on the other side of God. God like, yeah, you made it in, but you just made it in. I don't want to be like that, y'all. I'm like, I just made it in. I mean, it's good to be there. Amen. Praise God. We made it. But I want to be on the other side of receiving the commendation as well. I want to be up there crownless. Everybody else got a crown. I ain't got no crown. So I was too busy trying to impress people. The second reward, I think, this blessed me. This really blessed me. The second reward is knowing that God is celebrated. God is moved by our faith. Now, the Bible says something that blew me away. I just had never seen this before. This blew me away. After talking about Abraham and the patriarchs and how they operated by faith, and the Bible says that they didn't receive what God had promised yet because God was fulfilling all those things. But they did receive something that I thought was really, really moving. Let me read it for you. Hebrews 11 and verse 13. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, because God has said it. They saw it from a distance, because God said he was going to do it. You do understand there are certain promises that God has for your life that's not going to come in your life. It's for future generations. It says this, but having seen them and greeted them from afar and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exile on the earth, for people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. In other words, they know they're just traveling through. The reason why you don't get all your promises in this life is because this life is not home. That life is home. If you get everything you want in this life, you should be very concerned. Because then this is the best life you're going to have. But there's more for the people of God in the life to come. But look at what it says. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But look at this. This is what blessed me. But as it is, they desired a better country. They realized that where we're at right now is not what God is promising. It's going to be something better. So I'm not putting all my stock in this life. But this is what blessed me. That is a heavenly one. Therefore, I love this. I love this. It says, because they operate in faith, even though they didn't receive the promise right now. Abraham didn't receive the promise of the land. That came to his future generations. All right? Isaac and Jacob, they didn't receive that. That came to future generations. But because they still believed God, because they still trusted God, look at this. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. I said, what? We oftentimes think about us not being ashamed of God. But what a blessing to have God look at us. And God said, I'm not ashamed to be called your God. Isn't that a blessing? That blessed my heart. I said, listen, no one on this planet don't have to commend me or recognize me for anything. If God can say, I'm not ashamed to be called that brother's God. If God can look through heaven and look at Laverne and say, I'm not ashamed that I'm his God, that is a blessing in and of itself. What I don't want is to impress a whole bunch of people, but God is like, I don't know that brother. God says, therefore, the Bible says, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. You know, one of the blessings of operating in faith is knowing that God is not ashamed of you. I tell you, one of the worst emotions to me is shame. You know, as a child, you guys have all experienced this, I think, maybe, I don't know. But as a child, you know, you do something that you know your parents was ashamed. Remember one time I got in trouble in school, and they had to call my mama. My mama's here right now, right? They had to call my mama because I got in trouble. And I just knew my mom's going to be upset with me. It's a horrible feeling. And I never got in trouble again like that in school. Not like that in school. Partly because I didn't want her to be upset with me. But also because she told me if I get into trouble like that in school again, she was going to whoop me in front of my class so everybody could see it. And my mom does not give empty promises as it relates to getting whoopings. So I said, I ain't getting in trouble like that again. But isn't it a blessing when you know somebody approves of you? Isn't it a good feeling when you know somebody's like, you know what, man, you did a great job. Like, man, I'm glad to say I know you. Like, man, I'm glad to say that I know them. Isn't it even more a blessing to have God say that I'm not ashamed to be called their God? What a blessing. Lastly, I think the third reward is the reality of getting closer to God. You get closer to God by your faith. Let me put it like this. God is our reward. It's not just what God gives us. It's who God is. Now, many of us have lived life long enough to know that material things are not all that it's cracked up to be. Amen, somebody? I mean, you get material stuff and you're still unhappy. Material things is not all that it cracks up to be. But I tell you what, I'd rather have Jesus than the most fanciest, shiniest thing on this planet. Because at some point, that fancy and shiny thing is going to lose its shine. It's not going to last. But I want him. He is our reward. I tell you, as I close, I got to take it back to the King James Version. Because I love how the King James Version translates Genesis 15 and verse 1. Because I think it brings out the heart of the passage. This is when God reveals more of himself to Abram. And God says something very interesting. Let me just read it as we close. Genesis 15 and verse 1. The Bible says, after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram. Look at this. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. You know what God is saying? I am your reward. He is the reward. When you know God and when you experience God, everything else pales in comparison. When you experience God, you just know that everything else, in light of who God is, don't matter. When you can taste and see that the Lord is good, and somebody tried to give you some stuff from this world, you're like, man, whatever, that don't even compare to what God provides. We want to grow in our faith, church family, and I want to encourage us these next 4 days to ask God, to pray, to pursue God, so we can grow in our faith. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for your word and the truth of your word. And we thank you, God, that you are a God of promise and you fulfill your promise all the time. Not some of the time, not even the majority of the time. You fulfill your promises all the time. And so, Father, we thank you for that, Lord. We bless you, God, and we honor you, Lord. We do pray, God, that you will help us over these next 4 days as we want to be people of faith, because without faith, it is impossible to please God. We want to be people of faith. God, we want to trust you. So, Father, we pray over these next 4 days that you would minister to us. Allow us to experience you afresh and anew. May our faith be the kind of faith that you will be pleased with. May we have the testimony, God, that you are not ashamed to be called our God. May that be the testimony of Christ Community Church. God, we may not impress a lot of people. It might be a lot of people walk by here, run by here, drive by here, come through here, and not impressed by anything that we do. That's okay, because, Father, our heart's desire is for you to look down on this fellowship, for you to look down on this church body and say, I'm not ashamed to be called their God. May that be our testimony, God. May that be our witness. So, Father, we thank you, we bless you, we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're getting ready to conclude our service. Thank you guys so much for your patience. Let me just pray for us, and we're going to wrap up. If anyone needs prayer, wants prayer, or if anyone wants to get more information about Christ, when you give your life over to Jesus, we wanted you to connect with us after service. We would love to talk with you more about that. But let me go ahead and pray for us. Father, we thank you so much for your grace, your mercy, and your kindness. We honor you, Father. We bless you, and we love you. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory both now and forevermore. And all together, God's people said, amen. 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 God bless you, church family. Thank you so much. If you can stop the recording, if you guys can stay still for one.